years, I came to the new world thinking of a future. That day, he could have saved him. He would be, had he stayed, he would have been highly successful. He could have been, he would have been a senior professor. Canadian public service salaries at the time were significantly higher than their Irish and even American equivalents, and significantly reduced course load by comparison. He would have had the life of Riley. But that wasn't to be. He says, that they gave me, but as well, that new world gave me a past, alternative to our European past, to go home with. They gave me a past, a future, an alternative to our European past, in which includes the Irish, to go home with. They gave him not only a future, but they gave him a past, so he returned. That would bring him to the cusp of disintegration. The hermetic life he had lived in Connemara, the solitary's metaphysical deluding, the pioneer's hubristic temerity, they all failed in the end. He simply broke down. The wholesale renunciation of his culture, creed, and civilization, the no-holds-barred approach he took to his past formation, his total absorption into a new mode of being, commanded in the end a psychological and emotional cost of personally devastating dimensions. He was cut adrift. No words, struggling in a vacuum for new meaning, anything. He wrote, walking back down from the mountain near Lapitana, it happened. In an instant I was ruined. Ruined beyond remedy and repair. The universe had vanished from around me. I saw a last fading flicker of it, and then it was an infinite horror. And the terrible anguish was, not only was the world I had hitherto relied on for my sense of myself an illusion, it was in fact a deception, it was a lie. The way I had lived for the past 3 years, curling up in the swan's nest, healing my head, my hair's form, baptizing myself of culture, seeking to walk the earth with a barefoot heart and a barefoot brain, I felt that all of this was a genuine search for the truth, not merely speakable truth, but a truth I would surrender to, a truth I would live, that would live me, not just for myself, but for others as well. And now, in an instant, it had all ended in ruination. The world in and through which I had been a self, that was an illusion. It had vanished, leaving that infinitely isolated self in peril of disintegration. This is a bad moment. Swimming in the vortex of the self's unwinding, with little in the way of a still point, directionless and vacant, Moriarty somehow intuited in the heart of the maelstrom that, and I quote, he needed help in a way that I had never before. I fell instantly and instinctively back into Christianity. Whatever else would change the world. Christianity was my mother tongue. End of quote. Moriarty found that he could navigate the desolations of an age, desolations he saw realized in certain historical figures, but now he was not so sure. After all, he mused, it is one thing to find oneself engulfed in an infinite universe that was neither center or circumference. That he realized after reading Darwin. It is something else altogether for that universe to disappear, to vanish like a mirage, leaving you in the void. Undoubtedly, this wrenching experience was a potent mixture of the metaphysical, the psychoanalytic, and the void. It was a breakdown, or an acute clinical depression, or a luminous insight accorded only the mystically implied, or most probably, it was a combination of all three. But it was, indubitably, as the theologians would say, a graced moment. Moriarty conceded that up until now he had played with the Christian myth, but his transfiguration on the mountain shattered him into seeing. He says that it wasn't with my eyes that I saw it, it was with whatever was left of me that I saw it. I was a Christian, not a Christian again. I was a Christian for the first time. End of quote. Penance, and elicited that precious nugget of spiritual wisdom and balance of return. Listen to the conversation as he recorded it in his autobiography many years later. Is it madness? I asked. No, Father Robert said. Why do you think so? In madness, he said, the circle is closed. The person is engulfed, is often deluded, and isn't able to distinguish what is really profound from what is trivial. In your case, the circle is open. And he parted his fingers. You can walk around about your experiences, and you can make sense when you talk about them. Also, ours here is a contemplative house. If it was madness, we wouldn't have been able to go about the things the way we do. Instead of being a disruption, even during the quiet of an hour-long meditation, the contrary has been the case. End of quote. Although Moriarty could make sense of his experiences, and although he could draw deeply from the well of Sandman's spirituality in so doing, there was something as much conceptual as interpretive going on. He was engaged in a larger task, in rethinking dogma, a creative alignment of creation and redemption centered in the mystery and power of Tenebrae. John the Cross, he argued, took Tenebrae so seriously, and he would as well. Father Norbert's Carmelite house, Chilfo Priory, became for him a house at a frontier of human sea, a house at the wildest frontier of it all, the frontier of parable and passion. It was a house of healing, a sanctuary, where he could explore more deeply the inner recesses of his aching heart and empty soul, and what eventually would come from this Carmelite moment, framing chronologically other moments, personal and familial, mythological and psychological. And out of this would be the marriage of the cloud of unknowing with the dark night of the soul, a metanoesis by which he meant an experience beyond all mental activity, meta-mind, as it were. But we're talking actually about a mystical experience here, and this is always difficult in language to share. It can't be done according to the standards of ordinary discourse. That's why the mystics almost invariably use imagery to talk about their experience. And sometimes that imagery deeply discomforts us because we don't know what to make of it. It very often fits into the category of what is called the apophatic or the via negativa, a darkness, an absence, an emptiness, but which has at its heart an incredible luminous light. So going forth into darkness, rendering this insight and significance of Tenebrae more accessible, he provided the following anecdote. And this is a beautiful story. I noticed one night, crossing my kitchen to the light switch by the far door, I could see the moonlit sea through the picture window. Having switched on the light, I returned to the table and sat down. But now, to my great disappointment, I couldn't see the sea. The light I had switched on was eclipsing the sea. Switching off the light I had switched on, I went back to the table and sat down again. And I looked for hours at the moonlit sea. Sitting tenderly, my senses and faculties suspended, I see like I did that night. Sitting in tenderly, the eclipsing light of my mind, reabsorbed, I see. This is a critical understanding of Moriarty. His creation is construction of a new mode of seeing. For O'Delia, Moriarty comes to the realization that the workings of the human mind are inadequate when it comes to bringing us the transcendent one, and as a consequence, Moriarty deems the mind, and I quote, with all its luminosity and brilliant brightness, to be an obstruction, and he undergoes Tenebrae in order to suspend, if only temporarily, its eclipsing influence, end quote. Tenebrae also defines the way of reconnection with our evolutionary path. This trail brings us to the Earth's layers of evolution, to prehistoric times. This trail, a harrowing of hell, less in terms of Dante and more in terms of Darwin, is pioneered by Jesus. For all things, and I quote, for Stegosaurus and Rhinoceros, as well as for Mollusk and Moses. Again, this is only the kind of line that Moriarty would write. A wrestling image, and a wrestling image. Moriarty understands that this immersion in our geological past, this trail to the subterranean pulse of our species, must be reconfigured into ritual. And then he says, into sacred things, sacredly said, into sacred things, sacredly done. Not a systematic theologian. Well, he was a priestly presence to his devoted retinue, splendor of sacrament or liturgy, doctrinal correctitude wasn't really his project. The historical sedimentations of dogma mattered less to him than the archaic stratifications of the earth, whose geological intricacy, he realized, mimics the ancientness of our own individual anatomy, as criminal carnivores with sharpened incisors and a hunter's retina. The variable library that John Moriarty composed in patient longhand as a Connemara laborer, planting and pruning, digging and delving on the saline western seaboard, is as valid and as vital as the catechism of the Catholic Church. For it records in a crucial and excruciating way a passionate narration of the passion narrative itself, end quote. Story that we find or devise ways of living verily in time. The story isn't an add-on, a decoration, a divertissement. The story is essential to who we are. How we devise the story, how we tell the story, how we live the story, the narrative. Living verily in time, in and through the telling of stories, the very making of the human narrative is an activity touched by divinity. As Moriarty reminds his readers, and I love this line, only a great story can shelter us. Although Moriarty will need to redefine, reimagine, reappropriate this great story, he will do so by digging deeper into the sacred caverns of prehistoric times and by exercising the bardic role of he defines the state of religion in modern Ireland in stark terms. Read carefully, he's not flattering. And he will have no truck with an ersatz Celtic spiritualism, an ahistorical or unscientific love affair with a full Catholic Celtic heart that makes light of the ancient mystery and its authentic Christian soul. He is not interested in marketing a superficial spiritual. In an interview with Patrick Clancy on the cultural tradition, Moriarty noted, he said, I sometimes refer to how the ice cap comes down over the Arctic oceans, particularly currently now when we're facing that, and into the Arctic lands at the beginning of autumn, and how seals have to keep breathing holes open in the ice because they are mammals. They have to come up to breathe, these seals. They have to go down for food, and then they have to come back up and haul themselves under the ice in order to breathe. Now, I can see the sacraments of the Christian religion, for instance, as being the seals, breathing holes. Human beings need to breathe grace. If we were to ask me about religion in Ireland, I would begin to locate the heart of it in the poem, The Blackbird of Derry. There you have Ossian, the old pagan, saying that nature, symbolized by the call of the Irish totemic bird, the blackbird, is where we go to find healing and the magnificence and significance. Where we find our true worth. Then you have Patrick, ringing the bell, which calls us to transcendence. So you have the wrestling between immanence here and transcendence there. Now it seems to me there is something wonderful, a kind of healing, in listening to the blackbird. But in the end, it isn't the final healing. In the end, we have to listen to the bell.
He wasn't the most elegant, but he was the best. We knew him in UCD when I was there. He was a shining intellectual. I happened to live in Oxford for 23 years and used to go to Mass in Gore's Hill, where the priest said to me one day, what about our friend John Moriarty? So I had to sniff his trail there. And afterwards, when I came to live in Killarney and found him for the last years of his life contemplating in the hills, he was an extraordinary man. A man who would try to put his arms around the world, the world of knowledge. And it's a pity that you were speaking last week at Writers' Week, when this man of books and letters should have been a member of the football.